good afternoon, everyone. So delighted that you're all here. It's a great honor to for Yale once again host a discussion with two former heads of government who have a strong connection to this institution. Tony Blair, as described to you by Minister Wang, was of course Prime Minister of Great Britain, and for 3 years, starting in the fall of 2008, taught a course here on faith and globalization. And Ernesto Zedillo, who was the president of Mexico from 1994 to 2000, joined our faculty in 2002, where he's been, 2002, where he's been ever since as the director of the Yale Center for the Study of Globalization. We're going to have a conversation today on aspects that of the global affairs that interest them, in particular, faith and globalization, issues in the Middle East, what's going on in Europe, climate change, perhaps a few other topics. We have a number of questions that have come up on the floor. I will try to integrate into the course of the discussion in order to keep a good conversational flow throughout. We might start by asking Prime Minister to talk to us just a little bit by way of opening about his interest in faith and its effect on political and social life. We launched the Tony Blair Faith Foundation several years ago, started the course at Yale in 2008, and I guess it might be interesting, since many of you were not here for the introduction of this material here at Yale, it might be interesting to hear you, Tony, just sort of explain why you see faith and an understanding of faith is so fundamental to resolving the issues of conflict in the world and social problems of the world.
Thanks very much, Rick. And first of all, I'm going to say it's a great pleasure to be back at Yale, and thank you for our partnership over these last years that has been immensely productive and really enjoyable. And as one part of that, as well as running a course which is around faith and globalization, then we have these occasional events as well. So thank you. The reason I started a foundation around faith and its impact on the world is that I could see that two things were happening at once. The first is that the power of globalization and the technology associated with it is pushing the world ever closer together. So people interact more than ever before, physically through migration, online through the internet, and therefore the types of sort of homogeneous societies that there used to be have been replaced by societies that are very, very diverse, and essentially, therefore, how you understand other people, people from different cultures, nations, races, faiths, is an important part of understanding the world. At the same time, I could see that there was conflict, basically over half the conflicts today in the world have got a religious dimension to them. And this is very difficult for people to interact with each other. And what's happening in the Middle East at the moment, for example, you cannot understand unless you understand the role of religion. But if you look at the Far East, even take a country like Burma, where there's now around about 500,000 people being displaced in the last few months as a result of the dispute between the Buddhist population, the Muslim population in the west of the country. This is a global problem, which requires a whole set of different initiatives to resolve it, and that's the reason I wanted to start the foundation. And we have our education part, which is linking up schools at different faiths across the world. We've got an action program, and then we started the university program, which is about studying it and researching it. Here at Yale, we've now got almost 20 universities worldwide in the program. Just yesterday, I was in China, in Beijing, where we have a partnership with Peking University. Even there, this issue is now considered of fundamental importance to understanding the country and its development. So, in about 10 minutes, that's the reason.
Great. Why don't we start our new tour of the world here about, talk about some of the things that are interesting and involved in now very intensively. One of Prime Minister's post-governmental responsibilities has been to be the quartet representative to try to negotiate peace in the resolution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. The quartet represents the United Nations, the United States,
European Union and Russia. You've been at this for 5-6 years now, and 5 years, and it's still a pretty dicey environment with the, let's talk maybe first about Gaza, with the recent ceasefire in Gaza. Do you think that this is a sign of hope? Do the prospects look good for some kind of resolution building on that ceasefire?
I think when you describe it as this somewhat dicey situation, that would be described as an example of British understatement.
Exactly.
I actually just come back from my 90th visit to Jerusalem since leaving office. Although, as my wife said to me, it's not actually the number of visits you make, it's the progress that counts. Which I didn't think was remarkably supportive, I may say. The truth is, we are at an impasse, but there is a revolution sweeping the region. What happened in Gaza gives us a respite, but it doesn't alter the long-term problem. And what we need is for weapons to stop coming into Gaza and for Gaza to be opened up to the world again. Those two things are obviously linked. But you won't have a Palestinian state unless it's the West Bank and Gaza together. And at the moment, we don't have an ongoing peace negotiation. So, particularly with the re-election of President Obama here, I think we've got an opportunity to re-grip this issue. It's essential that we do it. It still remains, by the way, in my view, absolutely fundamental, both to understanding the Middle East and to resolving its problems. So, sometimes people will say to you, look, with what's happening in Egypt and Syria and Lebanon and all Yemen and all the different countries in the region, with what's happening there, maybe the Middle East peace process is less important. This is, in my view, fundamentally wrong. It remains of capital importance to the whole way the region develops. And if there were to be a viable peace negotiation between the Israelis and the Palestinians, I think it would have a remarkably beneficial impact on the whole region. It used to be said that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict helped to shore up the autocratic regimes around the region. It's been flame people there, Israeli sentiment. Now those regimes have fallen. But a variant of that observation was, it used to be said that if only Israel and Palestine could come to terms in some kind of viable two-state solution, that anti-Americanism would diminish in the region. Not so clear now, right?
Right.
The trouble is, it's, you know, what's actually happening in the Middle East, by the way, which is fascinating to a student of politics, is the politics in the Middle East is becoming like politics everywhere. And one of the things that people used to say to me when I was prime minister is they say, listen to the people. And I'd say, I am, but they're saying different things. And the truth of it is, in the Middle East right now, I think what you've got is a long-term struggle between two opposing forces. And some people think this is a somewhat simplistic way of looking at it, but it is a little crude the way I'm putting it, but I basically think this is what's going on, is that you have got three elements that are operating in the region. You have regimes that have been in power a long time, who we like to deal with because they provided stability, except they don't anymore. That's the first element. They've got some support, by the way, but they are basically somewhat tired and unable to deal with their situation now. Secondly, you've got what I would call your sort of Google liberal-minded elements, right? These are numerous, but badly organized. And then the third element are Islamists who are numerous and very well organized. And the truth is, the last two groups agree in getting rid of the first, but they don't really agree on what comes after. And so what you've really got now is these regimes have cast off, is you've got a struggle between what I would call those who believe that in the end the region's got to solve its own problems, that the way to do that is to open up their economy, to open up their society, equality between men and women, diversity of faiths recognized, and those who believe in creating a society actually based on a religious view and
really based on that, supreme over every other consideration. And this struggle, I think, is really, it's there. You can see it in Iraq, you can see it in Iran, you can see it in virtually every country in the region. And I think for America, the important thing is to realize, you know, it's, you know, anti-American, yes, there is anti-American sentiment there, but on the other hand, it also depends who you talk to, which is what I mean by saying not everyone thinks the same. So yes, some people, you could go to one audience and they would vilify America, you could go to another and they'd say, I quite like some of what they've got. So I think the important thing for us is how do we support what I would call the liberal modernizing elements within the region. And by the way, one aspect of doing that is to try and help resolve the Israeli-Palestinian question, because that is the one issue that has, I think, a very, it's not caused, and the problems in the region aren't caused by this dispute, don't misunderstand me, but the dispute has a kind of poisoning effect on relationships within the region.
So, whereas it might have been said in the past that the Israeli, the lack of a solution in Palestine lent support to the military dictatorships, now it tends to give the missileless issue over the liberal democracy.
Yeah, because people look, and one of the things that you learn about the world today, which is fascinating, is you've got to try and look at the world through the eyes of you know, when you've got a dispute, trying to look at it through the different set of eyes. So, because I'm so often in Jerusalem, then I see this dispute the way, you know, for example, it's portrayed on Al Jazeera, and the way it would be portrayed in the Israeli media. And it's literally like the same facts in two different universes. So, one of the problems that you've got is that, and this is why you need outside help to shape a negotiation that brings people together, is, you know, if you're someone living in the Arab world at the moment, you've seen those pictures of Gaza, of children being killed when the Israeli strikes hit Gaza, you know, you're angry, you're bitter against Israel, you're angry against Israel's allies. But if you're in Israel, you are looking at a million people taking shelter every night as rockets come in from Gaza, and where were it not for the Iron Dome defense mechanism, which takes 8 out of the 10 rockets and destroys them, you would have a lot more deaths and killing. So, but literally when you're out there, it's as if the universe doesn't exist on the other side, right? So one of the things that is really important today, particularly in the new media environment with the social media, which I think is a revolutionary phenomenon all in itself, is to try and build those bridges of understanding where people at least, even if they don't agree with the other side, understand why they're thinking as they're thinking.